Okay, welcome one and all to the first edition of HaskellerZ in 2023. I'm very happy that you all made it in such a large number. So to start the year off, we want to solve a long-standing question in the Haskell community, namely, have there been more or less jobs in Haskell over time? And Niklas here has kindly offered to solve this problem for us by writing a tool to check the number of job postings on Reddit, and he's going to show us how you build that kind of tool, and hopefully for those who've never used Haskell to do that sort of thing, or those who haven't done that in a long time, that will be educational. So please give it up for Niklas.
Okay, so over the past years, I've worked on Haskell jobs since 2014. In each of the jobs I've worked, there was always this feeling that, I have the feeling that this year there are like less job postings, so maybe like Haskell is going down over time, and I always had the opposite feeling. I felt like, well, originally there were only like a few larger companies that had like proper well-paid Haskell jobs, but over time I've seen on the Haskell Reddit more and more job postings where I would say, okay, these are like smaller companies doing all kind of diverse stuff. And I could never really prove it, and so now today it's kind of our job to figure out if I'm right or if the naysayers are right. So and I was thinking that we could do that by just like doing a little bit of like kind of beginner intermediate level programming. So I haven't really prepared too much for that. The idea is that we will just use one of the packages that allows us access to the Reddit API, and we'll have a look at how that makes requests. And what kind of problems there are with Reddit, because that part I have researched already before. And then maybe we can also do a little of manual data processing, since I see you all have your laptops ready. You can maybe help weed out the parts that aren't actually job postings data. But before, I wanted to like start with a little game. So I have here the first shared drawing editor that I could find on Google. I have this kind of whiteboard here, and we can draw some guesstimates. Everybody can draw like a little curve, basically, from 2008 to 2023, how the number of Haskell job postings have gone up or down or stagnated or whatever. So what you need to do is just go to this URL here, and I'm going to make this a little bit bigger in a moment, and then you can hopefully draw stuff in there. There's just this random editor here, and I think the easiest is if you click down here, and you can just put draw a little diagram, and then everybody can put their name or pseudonym or whatever. So the idea is
Niklas?
Yeah?
Can you show the URL again, please?
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
This is the URL. Here's 2008. Maybe I should use a smaller pen or something like this. But and then over here is like I'll show it again in just a second. And then here's like 2023. Yeah, there you go. You joined already. And then like here's like the number of job postings. And you can put like I don't know your own Y values here. I don't know 10, right? And then maybe I don't know. How it goes, right? Maybe like so put your name in, and then like the winner gets another one of these if you still have one. So I'm just selling out your food. Yeah, each do your own drawing, and then I don't know, we just see like what's right. That's the idea. Okay. And I rename my that like in the at the same time messages.
I does not have
too much slow stuff. Yeah, so while you're just like throwing stuff in there, I will just talk a little bit about Reddit. For those that don't know it, that's kind of like some kind of like hipster discussion platform that can't do all kind of stuff. But for some reason, people think that it's a good place to get computer support and to put job postings there. And why exactly people use it is unclear to me, because if you want computer support, like after like half a year or so, you can't comment anymore. So if that one guy from the internet came to answer your question, they can't tell you. But so we have some stuff in here, for example, fully funded PhD scholarship, trustworthy refactoring tools for Haskell programs. Nice. And we can see here already there's some extra features. So there are some mods on this Reddit, and they can put these kind of labels here. And I think they're called flares. So what we want to do, for example, is that we certainly want to include in our analysis everything that contains the job flair, which I think is put manually. And then also like all kind of other things in here. Here we have another job where it actually says the job in the title. It also says engineer at whatever company name is. So maybe we also want to search for things like engineer or role, stuff like that. How do we navigate around in Reddit? We should explore that first. So you can kind of click next, and you can see what it does there with the URL for the nouns and the beginning where in R Haskell. And then you can see that we get to this kind of after, and then some form of ID. And I looked that up before before the talk. So T3 just means like general submissions, and we can choose here also hot, new, and top. And if you go new, it's just the same thing, like sorted by date. So the first thing that I had in mind is we could just take new, and then like page name or group here, and just go all the way back to the beginning of time, and then like we get all of the titles, and then we just grab, search for in the titles for like jobs and the kind of things that we want to do. How can we get at this data? Well, we could either scrape the HTML, or we could use an API, which Reddit apparently has. So here on like Reddit.com, they have an API, they have an API in here, and I also explain some of these things. So for example, there's this concept of a listing, and we will see that in the Haskell API a little bit later again. And the listing you can kind of like paginate through by giving this like before or after parameters. And so that's kind of what this does. Like when you go here, it kind of takes the last entry and then it puts it into the ID, like at the bottom, you can see that here, and then it says after this one I want. And this is done such that because some of the Reddits that are very frequently used, they don't want to give like certain pagination ordering or so, so you just say what's the last one that I saw, and then this one just becomes the next one, the next after ID. Same thing in our code. How do you use the Reddit API? For this, you first have to read this page, so that you're linking you from one to another, like the API access rules. Okay, what are they? Apparently, this GitHub repo, which of course is now archived and is deprecated. So, nevertheless, it's still linked from the main thing. And then you can see you have to authenticate with OAuth2, whatever that is. And you also have to accept the API terms. So you click on that, we get here, so now we're back on Reddit. And then there's some more stuff about OAuth2, and then you can click read the terms and register, which brings it to a Google Doc. And then in the Google Doc, you put your Reddit username in, and then you can generate some kind of token that you can use for API access. And that's something that I have already done. So you get like a username and like some form of password, and that's what you're your scraper can use. And it's also important, it says that somewhere, I think here or so, that your scraper must say who it is. Like you need to say, ah, it's by Reddit user, blah, 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 and the purpose is this. I just called my thing the Haskell jobs scraper. Okay, so that's kind of, here's what this looks like. So on your Reddit page, in like apps, you then get like such kind of secret, and this is like a job scraper thing. And that's it, and then you can use these redactions. All right, so now we can do like a little bit of programming. So I found two packages on package that give you wrappers around the Reddit API. One is called Reddit and one is called Headed. Both didn't compile, so I picked one of them that I found more convenient, which was this one, and I just ported it to the newest version of the Haskell JSON library so that it builds again. I made two small pull requests to do that, and if you want to like join me in the programming in a moment, I have this. I think I have mentioned here. These are the conveniently there. Pull request number one in the project, pull request number two in the project, so it makes it kind of easy to know the numbers are. Okay, so let's look what this API offers us. So let's go in here. Actually, I have this prepared already. So how do we talk to Reddit? Okay, feature rich and comprehensive. Sounds really good. So the way this works is that apparently first we have to make some client, which I think will be some form of wrapper over an HTTP client with which we can make one or multiple requests. How do we make such a client? We can either use this new client thing here, where we use some form of auth config, and that seems to get this client ID and the app type and so on. Or we can also use this thing load client here, where we can write a mini file that has the secrets that we were given to by Reddit, and then we put them in here. So I would put this in here, copy paste it from the Reddit side, and then put it into this thing, which in my case is just here, home, config, edit, auth mini, that's where my secret is stored. And then we can use this convenient load client functionality. We give it the client side. I think if you don't want to use the normal Reddit, but you can, I don't know, maybe you can have a Reddit for enterprise or something like this, or maybe it gives you, I think this was the thing where you need to give the configuration section in your config file. So I think that's this one actually. So I just named this also default or something like this. You will see that in a moment. And then we get back a client. And with a client, then we can make multiple requests. Let's have a look. Yeah, here's this main thing. Run Reddit, so we give it a client and some kind of Reddit actions, which are in this Reddit Monads transformer here. Which multiple things can be done. And as we can see, it has a Monad IO instance, so we can also do some arbitrary IO in between, like printing stuff in the terminal if we want to, and then compute some values and turn that. Why do we have this wrapper? It seems to fulfill all kind of extra functionality. If you actually read the API requirements, it says some stuff about rate limiting. So see that here also it uses two different rate limiting mechanisms, and this wrapper has this convenient thing that if you do too many requests and Reddit tells you sorry I rate limited you, I think the default is 60 per minute, then it will automatically back off, which is kind of convenient. So let's just start. We can do some programming in here together, and we can see it's like this. Okay, so what do we want to do? We first want to, and we can even scroll a bit further. So we can do like run Reddit actions here. And I don't know why the browser is doing this now. Okay. That's great. And we will pick another one in a moment. Nice. Okay, I think this is a bug of my latest operating system, let's hope it's fine. Okay, so then what kind of Reddit actions can we make? I need to just go back here, top level. You can see here, for example, that we can make stuff with submissions and subreddits. I'm just going to open these two here. And in the Reddit terminology, we can get like rules, and we can do all kinds of things that you can do on Reddit, but I think one thing that we're interested in is that we can get new submissions here. And so this now, like, what does this run in? It runs in any M that's like a Monad Reddit, and this Reddit T that we were looking at before, that we can run here, that is one such thing. So okay, this is going to be the component written somewhere. I don't know where exactly it is, but it does work basically in the data. And so we can get new submissions. What do we give it? We give it like a separated name, and then we give it this kind of paginator thing. Let's explore this real quick. So this paginator is something where you can see this kind of after and before. And in this API, you can also do them at the same time, which doesn't make too much sense, I think. But the URL parameters allow that. And then you can also, in these pagination options, give like how many elements you want to affect. So let's try that here. And then it returns this listing, which we already saw in the API docs. In this case, it gives us then something of type submission. And let's see what this is here. So the submission is this. And we can already see that it has this kind of ID, which happens to be the thing with the T3 inside. And we can see who submitted it, what the title was, and so on. So that's really what we want to get. We want to get these titles, basically. And then we can do some other data analysis if we want to, like how upvoted or downvoted this was. So maybe we can find the most popular jobs. Got some kind of like Reddit mummy and so on. So, so that's what we want to do. And again, let's start with an example. So like if you're new to Haskell, then sometimes if you're lucky, the author of these libraries will have not only written these kind of comments or functions, but also some examples. So here we have one, for example, here's some kind of streaming stuff for like getting always the newest post as people post, and we don't really want that, but we can at least see where how do we make such a Reddit name, and how do we then run the Reddit actions. So let's try that here. So first we make, let's go back to the top, let's make such a client, and we use this. So what does this do? It does like a load client, which is this one here. We need to give it this client side, and in my case, that is a just, and then the name of what I have, my Inifier, which is the Haskell scraper. And what do we get out of it? Client in this case. And what can we do with this client? Well, we can use it later. So let's make a little plan in this case. Like use client to make requests, and then we say we want to, I would say, get new submissions, records, time, and maybe we will like write a loop to paginate, and then because we will berate it and maybe do multiple requests, we want to just save this the submission type that we have as JSON on disk, I was thinking, and then we can analyze it with whatever tools we want, either more Haskell or maybe like command line tools that we have there. For each post, we want to save it as post.id.json. So now we have a rough idea of that. Analysis, graphing. So that's kind of our goal in this case. So we already know that we want to do this get submissions in action. So let's put that here. That's this. Let's see. And now newly use the Haskell language server thing. So we can see like what these kind of things are. So we can do stuff like import fields of Haskell. So we can import it directly here. So let's maybe first import this thing. And we can use that. So what does this thing take? You get new submissions. Get new submissions. It takes this paginator. How do we make a paginator? Immediately we just scroll by here. We scroll here. There's this empty paginator, and we can start with that, and then we can update it. Here we have another example of something we probably need. Get the first page, this empty paginator that gives us like a new thing, and then we can call the next page if we want, and make the next request, and whatever we get out of the aspect. So let's try it with that. For getting submissions, you have this example, so that's kind of like already exactly. right? So maybe this, this name here, I just a new type, like a wrapper around this text string, around this text string for the Haskell value in that case. So let's run it here. That. That. And what does this give us in that case? So this gives us a F0 with listings in that case. And we can run that with the run ready, as you can see here in this example with this client. So we run the same and run ready with the client, and then we give it the action that we have in that case. And that should be roughly it. And then, oh yeah, we also need to give it the page data, and that would be the this empty. Let's see what's in this listing. Does it want to do the page data? Let's have a look. Sorry?
Copy paste the wrong thing in the page data.
Ah, sorry, you're right. The empty page data, I think, was empty.
Are you seeing overload strings? This is just like overload strings.
Yeah. Okay, that's
interesting.
Okay, so now like we do like this load client, and this requires like text here, so we will enable like overload strings in here. And with this we can use like any kind of string like types as string literals, not only as the list-based string type, but also text. So that works. And now we have like that screen here, the list. This also won't work because we're still in this inside of run Reddit. We are in this Reddit T type, but since there's a smaller IO, we can lift IO here. And then we also need the lift IO in this case. I'm wondering if this can do that here. I'm still kind of new to this integration, but maybe I'll be more in this direct. So, this one, and then there we go. So let's see what this does. Okay. There we go. Okay, so we have some stuff in here. So, let's maybe, what is this listing? Let's have a look. What get submissions actually gives us? It gives us a, what is it? Here, bring new submissions. It gives us this listing. What can we do with the listing? It's a listing of A in this case. And aha, we can again access before and after, and then we can also get the children. So, print the children here in this case, okay, the children, like that. And then this gives us what? A sec, what's a sec? It's from data sequence, okay, let's have a look what that is exactly. Okay, this kind of thing apparently it's something where you can conveniently append to the front at the end efficiently, but like the key thing is that we can just use this foldable instance, for example, to get a list of it. So for anything that's foldable, you can to list like this, and we get a list out of it. And we can also, if you want to, we can use this kind of thing for. So for any kind of container that contains, so T is the container, that contains some A's, we can use like a lambda function or like a fall back if you wish to do something with it. So we're going to do that here. So instead, we're going to do for all of the children, the listing child, and this will be a submission, I believe. You can see in a moment if that is true. Child in this case. Let's see what it says. Okay. I think we need to import this thing again, so let's get this here. So that was this, and now it wants something like children. Let's see what exactly that is. So let's import it here. I don't think we have that, so we need to see where the children comes from. This thing here, and we are in this one. Get it? They say so. Do you do it? Why is it this way, by the way? I have checked that before. So this thing like uses record fields that all have the same name. So for example, stuff that has like before and after, the paginator has it, the listing has it, and so on. So the way that this package by itself recommends to be used is with lenses and overload the record fields, which allows you to not have like, unique functions in here, but I found that that's kind of overkill, so just do it directly. So let's have a look here. And here we get them out, and then we have one here. So that is the submission. So maybe we will just print a little bit less now. How about the submission ID and the title? So let's do here. So this is a submission. Let's see if this is true. We can ask it here. Okay, let's add some type variables and it says, yeah, this is a submission. So let's write it here. Like that. And then now we want to print the submission ID and also the what was it, title ID.
Niklas, try record destructuring pattern matching
yeah,
up there.
That's a good idea. So, like one reason why this could be, I'm still a bit confused why it says not in slow, but I think let's do this here. Because we have multiple fields in this case, we can do this.
Now you can use it on the lambda parameter where you take submission of type submission. You can instead write submission.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Let's do that here. So we have here this submission. Oops.
Yeah.
And we can put it here. with like name few parts, we can bring it to the scope. I'm not even that. So that.
probably need to import the whole constructor.
We don't have the constructor. Let's do the whole thing. There we go. Okay, so now it's ambiguous in this case. And let's just see which one is ambiguous, 23. Okay. Now we need to say from which one we want, because I think we have multiple ones in this case. Let's see if I can show what it is.
Try record wildcards. Try record wildcards,
okay.
Maybe it'll work, because then you're not specifying the name. Voila.
I believe that we have queried in this case. So now we want to get more results, of course. So let's first try and get the second page. For this, we would have to see. We get out like a new, let's see what this is actually. Like, from here, we get out a listing, and then we want to get. But we want to get the next page. For that, we can use the screen that we saw before. Let's see how well this works. Here's the next page. Let's give it a try. So let's make this here like this is the list again. We want to get the next one, so we will just take a next page of this thing that we got out, and this was a listing, I believe. So let's try the next page. Here we have it. It takes like this one. So that's a maybe paginator, and I think for that one we can just give the one that we got out. We can also maybe try the empty paginator. Let's just see what happens. So that's nothing here in that case. And now we get the previous listing. And that is listing two. And that is also this. So like that. Okay, so now we need to see what we're doing wrong here. Next page, then he takes a nothing as the first thing, and then it takes a listing TA. What is this one here? This is a listing a submission, IT submission, so that seems legitimate. Say again, sorry. It should still be technically, I think it should still be.
Next page produces a paginator, not a Reddit T, so you need to pass that to get
this one is
get
the
new submissions.
That's right. So that really gives us like a new paginator. And then we get the result like this, and we still do the same subreddit, but we take the new paginator. That seems better. Let's see if that's true. Now we still want to have a, I think.
Now you need a let for that. It's not in the monad. It's just a pure function.
This one here, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so let's insert that here. There we go. That's right. So as we can see, the next page just takes a listing and makes us a page maker. So that's the one. And let's look what happens. Okay, so here we have the next page. That's pretty good. So now we just need to generalize it to have arbitrarily many pages, and then we are good to go. So let's see, maybe let's say we want to do some general processing in this case. I'm just going to rename this process listing, and maybe we will later then save that listing here. But next, we want to write the root out of it. So we start with like our page name out there, and then we can make like how we call it, like process page or somewhere like pages, maybe. And that takes like a page data, and then we do what we do here, right? So, and then maybe eventually we will put again like pages, like next page data, like that. Okay. And then eventually we will call this room. When are we done, right? Probably when there are no more submissions that come out of the are in the listing. So maybe we do something like the non-submissions. In this case, it's just the length of these children. Our next page maker, I think that would be this, right? So we have like that would be this. We need that also. So import it in. There we go. And let's have a look. This kind of stuff we're done with, I think. So this goes away.
You just remove line 21.
I think that, but I still want to use this one here, right? Ah, we didn't call it page data here, I see what you mean. Alright, so now we have this. And maybe we do like a little bit more, which is just count how many we already have. So maybe we start with 0 and we add like okay. This is the ones that we already have, and then we have like non-submissions is here, so we have like new total ones is now total plus the new submissions, and non-submissions, and then we just have the new total here.
You want num total, not new total.
Num total, yeah, 1 second. So this num total here, that's the new total. And then maybe we can print like how many we have in total. So after we do the request, we can say submissions so far. we can make this whole thing, I would say we just keep it running here. Maybe we should also be like a little bit nicer to the API if we want to put sleep in here ourselves. And we maybe also want to query a few more than these 25 which are there by default. So in the way that we can do that is if we look for this page editor here, there's this function somewhere called limit. In the paginator, you can provide this limit, which is just like a word, so 255 in this case, and the maximum is 100 apparently. So that's good. So here, and we put limit, it's 100. So then it should be 4 times faster. And it's good like for us. It does not get internal. So the first one we got, let's go here. The first one we got was 100, so that's nice, but afterwards it continues with the 125, and I believe.
Probably in next page you want to pass the old paginator instead of nothing.
That's right. So here you can get the next page. Let's see where it was. Here. And with this maybe paginator here, and that kind of sets the options here. If this is nothing, the defaults will be used, otherwise we use the defaults from the paginator, so let's put the existing paginator in there. And
just
that knows the speed and maybe, so we put it just script, that's right. Okay, let's see how our progress is now. There we go. So now we are at 100, 200, 300. Great. So let's keep this running for a moment. And then we might find another issue. Let's see how many we have. Okay. Search for one of these. An issue that we find is that now it returns the same stuff multiple times. So we see like here we're like just before like 1,100. First, that's not a multiple of 100, so where did the other ones go? And second, we just got this at like 1,100 and then again at 2,800 basically. So what the hell is going on? And when I first tried this out, I like, debugged a little bit, and I found that Reddit has this fantastic behavior that you can only query 1,000 of a thing ever, and more isn't allowed. And if you get to like 1,000, basically, then you just get wrapped around from the beginning again. So this means we can let this run forever. And the most annoying thing is that when we actually go to the Haskell Reddit, I'm going to go there again. So if you actually go to like Moon, for example, and you click next, you get the next 25. And if you do this 40 times, you will see that after 40 times 25, 1,000, the next button will be gone. And you will still be in 2022, and that's kind of very bad for like making some judgments about 2008. So what do we do about that? So it kind of means like it's completely useless to do what we did here for like historical research purposes. But I wanted you to feel the pain that I felt when I discovered this. However, what could we do about that? You have some ideas? What could we do about that? Oops. Apparently I'm now on the new Reddit, even though I explicitly wanted to be on the old Reddit. Okay. So like one thing that we can do in this case is that whatever you query from Reddit, you can only have 1,000 of those. So what we can do is we can use the SER search for things and hope that less than 1,000 will come out. As long as we keep our search precise enough that we have less than 1,000 results, they will be returned here. So the idea is, instead of crawling everything and then like doing the analysis, we already do some educated guesses and use the search feature. So let's try to find that in the API. So let's have a look. There's somewhere in here. There is search. Let's see where exactly it was. I think let's find this. Search submission. Alright, so what does this API? Again, takes a paginator, but it also takes a search. What is a search? That's this. So let's maybe look at the code in this case to like see more in a nicer way what exactly we have. So okay, use the text to search, and then this is the subreddit. We want to search in the Haskell subreddit, and then there's the syntax that we want to search with. Let's click that. What syntaxes do we have? Let's click down here. So we can search either with a Lucene syntax or with a Cloud Search syntax or the plain syntax. And I think this is the default one. And Reddit explains this. If you click Advanced Search, you can see what exactly we can search for. So for example, we can search for, I'm not sure if it's actually mentioned here, there's the search FAQ, I think. And then there we can find that. You can search for the title, for example, the title cats. You can also search for flares, and so we will do that. So let's try and do it this way now. So we change our request. Instead of new submissions, we will use a search. And that's going to be this one. So this now takes this search. So this will be a search with Q being whatever the search term is. So let's say we say that for now the search term is all. So that would be the search term. Then we have the subreddit. Subreddit. This is going to be the just or subname. And then the syntax. We leave the default with nothing in this case. And we keep giving it the paginator. And now we need to figure out what it wants here. Okay. So let's see. Say that again. Right, we have the type here still. So we have to go away. Here we go.
Subname. Couple of
and then we need the subname, and the subname comes from whatever this one.
Capital case. Uppercase.
Which one?
Uppercase N. Should the search term be title job, not just job?
That's right. Like this. Okay. So I think we can also put like job in general, then it will also find posts, I think, but we want to put like titles like this. So that sounds good. Let's give it a shot. Oh, sorry, I didn't load. Okay. Job. Looks pretty good, right? And now another thing that we can do is that, let me just have a quick look. We can print the paginator that we're dealing with. So the new paginator was this, like this. Let's just put this here. Next paginator. Let's print that and analyze what exactly Reddit does when it does this kind of wrapping thing. Okay. So we can see here that here we have one, for example, that it sets after, right? Where is it? Here. This. And then, so this is like just, but another thing that I found is that when it does the wrapping, it sets, oops, I should stop here, right? It sets after equals nothing. Sorry, that was, yeah, that's right. So it sets after equals nothing. So if that is the case, then we are done, right? When it's at the end, it just sets that instead of like not giving us anything new, it sets it to this. So let's do that here in that case. So we can say that we do the looping only if there's a just in that after of the next page meter, then we do looping like this. And otherwise, we just say finished crawling by total submissions for term. What was it? Search term, right? Search term. And let me say is that was, we have like new total, right? Like this. Alright, so like that. And I think this one here is a text, but we want a string here. Let's unpack it. Like this. Let's unpack it. Now we need to do this thing here. Like it's just, I think we don't have that, so we can.
Well, just, why not just use pattern matching?
Yeah,
case.
Exactly. So now we have the same issue before that we want to use after, but there are multiple afters in scope. Let's just see. Show that again, like this. And I think that if you, I had in the past when I tried this out, I think you can even make the error message better. Right? Because right now it says it's not in scope, which kind of is really a lie, right? Because we already have. Actually, we don't have it here. But I think we will still say that in the case. And that's kind of like, that's kind of a bad error message. And I think that if you enable like the overlay labels, for example, it will just say that it's actually. But we will do the same thing here now again. So we can do, to resolve this ambiguity, we can case again on the next paginator. And that's going to be a paginator with like after in here. And then we can do that is just after.
We can get rid of the if this way as well.
Yeah, we can do that too, yeah. So let's bring it this way. So if this is so we can do if after is, I guess we would say like nothing, right?
And you still want
then we finish the thing, right? And else, so let's bring it right here. Otherwise we do pages. There we go. Okay, and I think it may be we may still need to have, yeah, I think it's up. Let me see. Oh, and this one, right? Just need to check. Yeah, okay. So I guess we need to do the same thing still, because for some reason it only work. It doesn't work with the main field plans, or like it doesn't work with general mention. It's a bit annoying. Maybe we can find a place by accepting that case. So I guess we can I believe. I'm not I was actually wrong. Simplify now, but it's good enough for our purpose. So let's see if it finishes. There we go. So now we have 221, and it's not moving around anymore, so that's working. So now the only thing that we need to do is that we want to do that for all of the search terms that we want to have. So
may I interrupt you?
Yeah.
I think your battery is running empty. Do we have a power plan?
Yeah, it would be better actually. Okay, we do
that. Otherwise, it will be fine.
We do that. We do the short break. Can already think of like some things that we want to search for. I don't know, synonyms of like job list. If you want to hire somebody,
hiring.
What would you write?
Blockchain.
Yeah.
Free cookies.
Thank you for that free tip. Good. What are our search terms? Let's say
hiring.
One sec. So that's unique. Let's keep this word thing here. Where do we put the search term eventually? We put it in here, right? So let's just make a little function here that is like search results for search term. Typing job, we also have this ability to do this with like this flare thing, so I was thinking that might be nice to get as well. What did you say?
Hiring.
Hiring, that sounds good. So types. Okay. And what else do we have? Who do you want to hire?
Developer.
Engineer and
employee, employment.
Vacancy, yeah, that sounds good. I was thinking for employment, you might get more like kind of questions or something like that. Another thing that I sometimes saw was like role and position, maybe.
Senior?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, that's good.
Australian.
Yeah, I think it's an English one, so I'm not sure they would.
Maybe junior as well. Why not?
Okay. Okay. That seems good so far. All right. So now we want to do the above for all of the search terms. So like for search terms.
In the very bottom where you call the four.
Am I not in this one?
Yeah, the four is intended to four.
Okay, there we go. And now we can maybe comment out just the big details, and then we can see where was it here? Here's our print, right? Want to write them to disk, I would say, so that we can analyze them with whatever else we want to do. So for that, I was thinking that we would serialize the submission to JSON and write that on the disk. So let's grab a fantastic JSON package, have a look how we can do that. that sounds good. Give it where to save it, and then anything that can be turned into JSON can be given to this function. So let's do that instead of the printing maybe. This looks good, right? We have already a couple of things in here. So let's do encode file and then the submission. So let's put the submission S in this case, this one, and then we put it into like our, let's say, search term, and then we put the name of the submission in here. So that was, I think, the submission ID, I believe, like this, and then .json.
Lift.io?
Say again?
Lift.io, right?
Yeah, that's right. So
it's
just
there.
I have one up here, actually, so that will work. So the search term, let's put that as, let's put this as job searches. Just want to check if that's, that seems good. And then we also have to make sure this directory actually exists. So maybe we do this like ahead of time for our rule. So maybe we don't that. This one, we don't make parent directories, we just make the search dirt here. And that's the file path. Okay. And then we also want to have this. And then we want to also have, I think this one is already important for me. Submission ID, and that's apparently not a string. That's a package. But a submission ID is a thing that has apparently has its full name thing, so we could use that, or we could also we could also use the same case that we did before. So maybe we do it like this. So we do like file name. Submission S, that was right, and then we unpacked it here, and then that is the file name, so then we put this here, file name, like that. Okay, and now I think submission ID already came from here, and what else do we have? Okay, so now, oh no, good, but we use two JSON submission, so this means that this submission that we have here. This one that has a from JSON instance because it uses JSON to parse this stuff out, but it doesn't have a to JSON instance in that case. We could write one now, but then we might have problems parsing it back in because when we do so, like the simplest thing that we could do, for example, in this case is that we just say, okay, this thing has a generic, and with JSON everything that has a generic instance, we can make a JSON instance for. So we can do like instance to JSON for submission, like that. And let's just see that. Okay, so here we have now a problem because a submission apparently contains an awarding, and an awarding also doesn't have a JSON instance. So, okay, whatever, right? Now I'm just gonna import this one also. And what else do we have? Oh, this contains all data. Well, let's put that here as well. And you see where this is going, but we are strong and we can do whatever it throws at us, right? No problem here. An item report. Oh yes, of course. We also need an item report. Oops, sorry. And then we need a call option. Yes, yes. And what else do we need? A submission contract. Very good. This is a very good exercise to tell people that if you make a parser for something, it also makes sense to include the 3D printer already with it. Because otherwise people will be copy-pasting random types from your library all over the place, any orphan instances, which you don't want to see. So it's also a separate thing. Okay? And then we need an award ID. But fear not, I have counted how many there are before in here. So I think we're good now. There we go. Already finished. So this is one thing that we can do. But there is a trick to this, which is that now it will use the generic ASIN instance, which will, for example, serialize this SEQ, the sec that we have there, as let's say sec. And the library itself, when it has written its from JSON instance, it may have, it may just parse things as they come, for example, as a list, and there will be like no sec wrapper object in it. So basically what we did now here is we made a to JSON instance that is not in agreement with the from JSON instance. If we just want to write stuff to this, which is what we want to do now, then that is totally fine. But if we want to write a submission to this and then read it back because we want to do more analysis in Haskell, then that would be bad because we couldn't parse it. Because we write, so let's say, a wrapper tag for this SEQ thing, and then the parser doesn't expect that and it will fail for that. So what do we do in this case? Well, one simple thing that you can do is that you just add a wrapper tag. So for example, you add your own submission with things that you want to have inside, and that's just a subset of the fields that are included here. Let me just import what's inside, and also this guy. And then we also need, because I do a generic deriving, I need to say, derive generic this here. So this is I'm working on. Now we have orphan instances, so we can say, please don't warn about them in this case, because that's okay. Because we don't like any kind of like need to operate with other programs in that case. And I'm just going to do a cleanup here. This one we don't need. That was not the one, I think. It was, that's just the application. And I think we also don't need this. Okay, great. So now instead of using serializing the submission, we can serialize a simple submission, but of course we need to make it first. So let's say we have a simple submission. It's the well, we basically want to copy over all of the fields from this submission here, which we named them the same way, into this new thing. So we can do, for example, that we just do here this simple submission. And now we just use record wildcards to get all of the variables in scope from the submission dot equals submission. And I'm not a big fan of record wildcards because there are, and I call it submission aspect. I'm not a big fan of record wildcards because it uses variables that magically come out of scopes. For example, this after I can't visually see where it comes from. If I have an ID, like in this case, it shows me this gets underlined so I know it comes out of here. But if I'm browsing some code and just reviewing it in some review, that's not so good. So usually I don't like that kind of stuff. But this for me is kind of one of the places where it's actually fully legitimate because you take all of the fields and you put them like back in here. So I think that's fine. And there's nothing that there's no value that I could be looking at where it's saying, okay, where does it come from? So and now we want to serialize a simple submission, of course. And let's see if we can do that. Okay, that's fine. And now I think we should be ready, go and we call our thing job searches, right? Like that. Here we go. Okay, so now we're saving it here. Let's have a quick look with JQ in job searches. First one here. That looks good, right? This oversized spread says, okay, whatever it says. Yeah, is Nix important for a team of one developer? Very controversial question.
The answer is obviously yes.
But so now, okay, so we have kind of like done our scraping now, and I think we're kind of finished with the HaskellerZ part for now. So now we just do some really cheap and easy analysis of the results that we've made. So we're done in here. Let's see how many results we have. So job searches is like, we have like 598 results in that case. So that sounds good. And conveniently, because they have IDs, it doesn't really matter if we overcount something. So for example, if something has title job and flare job, they both just write to the same file, like one after each other, so just overwrite the content, so it's fine. So we can overcount things here. So now we can do just a little bit of analysis if we want to. So for example, like one thing that I want to do is that I want to just print the date and the title, and then put them all in the big spreadsheet, and then we can, as a like, collaborative effort, just split them up, like everybody looks at 20 of them and sees if it's actually a job-related thing, because is Nix important also for a team of one developer? Isn't really offering any job, right? We should kind of exclude that. So that's one thing that we can do, and in this case, we're just going to do that with JQ. In this case, why not? So we can do here, like, let's do like for all of these guys, we want to print some stuff. So we use string interpolation, which works with backslash and some things in here. So for example, I can write now here the title that we got it here, like this. And now I also need to do it correctly. Let's see what we have here. I need to
double.
Sorry, this one needs to be so. With the outer, with this code, I'm kind of quoting the shell argument, but I want to return a string for JQ, so I need to have another backslash, and then I need to escape in this case. So it's like this. Okay, here we have that. And then I also want to print this without the quotes, so I put our raw output, so maybe this large, like that. Okay? And then what else do I want to print? I also want to print. I also want to print the date which was created, like that. So like this, maybe I remove the trailing space here in this case. So that's great. We want to import the whole thing into something where we can like collaborative filter stuff. I think Google Sheets is a good choice for that. So we could import stuff into Google Sheets. We should use a tab here, so then it will auto put this into a new field. So here's a tab now instead of a space. And then we have a couple of things. I don't know if you can see some of them here also. For example, here this, where there's just a new line. So maybe some kind of new line filtering would be good. We also have this new position at the university, right? So we can do some more filtering here that I have already prepared for filtering the title a little bit. So the way that works is that you just like split by new lines, like you would do it otherwise, and then you join it back space, so that would be like this, right? And then maybe we also want to remove any tabs that we have inside so that we don't get new cells in our spreadsheet. So we can do it like that, perhaps. And now we want to sort by date. And now we have a look. We have this kind of stuff, and it's all kind of nice, except of course for the lines that are wrong, but then just like it's made, so we can that. And now we just copy paste them all. And put them into a Google Sheet. And immediately I have done that already. So I can do that. I have created the following Google Sheet, which is this. One second, type the results. There's a new two slides here. Okay. And so I've just, if you take this whole thing, so I can actually demonstrate it quickly. This, we take that, we copy paste it, then automatically have like the date here and this here, but the date is like in the only proper format to write dates is ISO 8601. But of course, the only format that Google Docs cannot parse is the format that everybody uses. So instead, we need to put the created here and we need to parse it. And we can parse it with string parse time. Like this. We can string parse time in the 8601 format, and then we can string format time again. That kind of stuff. So now we have something like space and no Z at the end. And that's something that Google Docs actually understands. So this is, of course, we're living in this sheet. We can use my sheet that I prepared already. Yes.
Niklas, are you going to share these one-liners somewhere?
Yes.
Yes. They are absolutely incredible.
Yes, yes. They will be in the, they are already in the repo that I put on the internet. So now we have this, and now we want to draft this whole thing, right? But for, so in the beginning, we just have this column, and now we make another sheet, which is that the first thing I wanted to show is just how does the number of total job offerings grow over time? So I just want to have like an increasing number. So for that, apparently, the best way to do that in an automatic fashion, of course, you could do like 0, 1, 2, like grab them here and then extend with the slider, and like sheets would complete it. But we want to make it such that when I now click share and I say everybody on the internet can edit, don't do anything nasty, then copy link, here we go, and now I want to share this with you, and now we're going to put this with, how did this go, like Z bar, was it this one, no, the QR.
Why not put it in the meetup link, but you're...
Do you want to expose that to the internet?
This is already quoted. I think that's already quoted. There we go.
Wow.
So now you can like, scan that if you want.
That's going to be neat.
Go for it. There we go. Unicode is great, right? So that's this. And I will also put this link. I'm just going to put it somewhere else. So, for example, I'm just going to put it on my website. So you can click it. So what we want to do is that if there is a line in here and we delete it, that of course like this, the next one then becomes 3, because our count keeps going up. And this can be achieved with a very simple line, indirect address, like one row of same column plus one. So this way I can now right click here, input row, and it still correctly counts up. So in a moment we will split up those things, but before we do that, we can already look at some preliminary results. But again, before we do that, it's time to like check some of these things. Okay, so here we have this. And can I zoom? Yes, okay, so it's, here we have some kind of like logarithmic thing. I don't know, what's here, one? Or like what's the average? What's the, how many are we talking here? Like 10,000 or?
100.
So this is yours? Okay, so we put like 100, right?
No, let's put 10. 10.
Okay. 10?
10,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, and also, so we are talking about per year, right? So 10 job postings per year?
Yes.
Okay, 10, yeah. So, and then you're saying this is like which year?
What was the first year, 2008?
I mean, here is like 2023, right? 2008 is the first one.
Okay, so put 08 there.
Which one here, 0?
Yeah, 08.
So, I mean, yes, 08, but okay, yeah. What I mean is like, sorry, I should ask this. And where are we here? Just like, do you have a rough scale? Is it like a logarithmic scale? Like, we're at 10,000, or like, what's your guess?
Wait, total, cumulative.
I mean, sorry, I guess like 23
200.
Is income. Let's say 22, right?
Wow.
200? 300, 200, yeah. Okay, let's see how it works. Okay, that's like this, all right, fresh. So what's the lower one? 20. 20, okay. All right, and the upper one? Like 50. Okay, thank you. Okay, and then we have this, which is another different one. So here we have, what would be like, kind of like the start and the end for like 2022?
Maybe 100 and 200.
Okay. All right. So we're getting close now to the revelation. Let's see. So we do a diagram here, right? Of just like printing these two. So this here and then clicking, and I've done it already. And now, important to know, this now what's going to be printed is going to be the cumulative, right? So it will only go up. But the question is, at what rate does it go up? So, here we go. So this is the, in total, since 2008 or 9, I think it was 2008, like we had around 700 job postings posted. And it seems here like the rate goes up slightly. And then like just at the very end of 2022, it goes down a little bit. So. That would be that. And now, of course, we can also say, okay, the cumulative is not super interesting. Let's instead try and just group it by year. And trying to do that in Excel or Google Sheets is way beyond me. I don't know, that kind of stuff. So we use more powerful tools, the bottom shell. So what we want to do here in this case is, so we have this whole business, right? And now we can just say we want to do we want to just like filter some stuff in here. So let's say we grab the year for let's sort first of also fine, and then we grab for 2022 minus, right? And then we start from here. Right, so now we have that, and now let's see how many we have in 2022. There we go. So now we know this one, which is of course also very easy to do, in the most powerful programming language that the world has ever come up with, which everybody should use. So let's echo.
This was Haskellers, not Bashers.
And then we have this whole business.
Isn't that the setting at the year?
You didn't grab correctly, my dude.
One sec. The year needs to go in here. This case. There we go. And now we copy this. Highly sophisticated analysis tools. Now we want to maybe
Is that right there?
Yeah, there we go. So here you have it, right? So this is like, looks like 2021 was the most powerful year. Maybe I'll switch it back. Switch it back to the dots. Where is this? There we go. That seems fine also. Yeah, so this is how it goes. So I think if we want to see, yeah, this is so, I mean, clearly this is following like the current curve and it's how it is, right? So I would imagine that like in 2 years we should be somewhere up here. But yeah, so this is how it goes. So the answer is like over time, the number of Haskell jobs is very clearly increasing and the naysayers are wrong. And we are ready. So that's kind of it. Everything I wanted to show. And if you want to like use some of the stuff that I have in here, let me just see if I have actually pushed it already. It doesn't look like it. One second. Okay. I think I made the repo, but I don't know if I actually did. I make the repo like in 5 minutes after the talk, and it's going to be github.com/nh2/HaskellReddit/jobs-counter. And processing the shared stuff that you were interested in here, so you can check that out. And yeah, if you have a little bit of time now, you can maybe go into the spreadsheet and in sheet one, just split up the lines and find everything that's illegitimate, right? So the way I would do that is like, how many people like have laptops? You would have to do the work. The other people on the phone, we spare them. So we have 1, 2,
it's only 100 entries.
3, 4 laptops, okay. So then we just put this way, we have in total, like 519 in this case. I haven't searched for like, what was it, developer yet? Because like, there's a bunch of developer in there. So we could use this one, but of course we can later. And then I was thinking maybe we just like split it into 4 parts. So we just do like from 0 to 100, from 100 to 200, and we nuke everything that's not a job posting. And then we don't want that anybody comes and tells us, oh, this is just like big data, right? It's fake news for the jobs. And then when we're done, maybe in the GitHub repo, I would put like the final graph that we get out of it. So that it can be linked, and then I will get the sweet Hacker News karma. So, yeah, that's it. And thank you for like cleaning the list if you had to.
Okay. Are there any questions about what has been presented? Now would be the time to ask them.
Maybe not Python, but something which is rare.
Yeah, you would have to find one where there are less than 1,000 results for anything that you search, right? And I was already thinking of how exactly you can do that. There are some complications. So for example, I found that if you search for a position or for a job, the underlying, whatever they use like LinkedIn or whatever, it thinks that these are synonyms and will return exactly the same results. So this means that if you want to bring down the number of results under 1,000, you can't, for example, filter by job and then filter for like A, B, C, D, like all letters in the alphabet to just like break it down further, because it may use these kind of like synonyms instead inside.
Would it be possible to limit the search on some time frame? Because then you can do time frame after time frame.
I don't know if that is possible. I haven't found one yet, but we would have to. I think this was the page, right? So I don't think time is a possible filter here, but of course it's a good idea. Like if it's possible, we should definitely do that. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. Manipulate the data.
Sorry?
You manipulate the data.
That's true, yeah. That's the, you may want to remove one. Yes. Let's see. I mean, I think like this one doesn't have the right shape, right? So I think like the contenders would be like this one and this one. I check at the end of the numbers, like with like 100 to 200. That's kind of like factor two off at the end, I would say. And like a lot of